Kathy, thank you for giving your time up to me today for this. I really appreciate
it. Hey, my pleasure.
And, you know, you are such a wonderful champion for other women. Yeah. And you've certainly been really encouraging for me over the years. So I just want to get your thoughts on a few different things that I think can be issues for women. And firstly, I mean, obviously, we know there's still a massive gap for women, you know, politically, economically, just across the board in pay. You know, what do you think it's going to take to ultimately close that gender gap so that the gender gap doesn't have to be a word, a term anymore?
Yeah, right. We need to make it history.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I feel the moment is right now that suddenly women are speaking out about it and men are reacting defensively and now pretty offensively because they're getting it, that there's something seriously wrong, that this has persisted for such a long time and has been almost impossible to budge. So one of the best things that's happening now is that there's data that says it's not just that it's wrong to have a pay gap, but it's actually not smart either. Yeah. And that if we could eliminate it, we'd put $28 trillion more back into the economy. That's just nuts that we aren't taking the steps to do it. So I'm seeing suddenly big companies standing up at the World Economic Forum saying, we're addressing this because it's not in anybody's interest and we know it's wrong. Yeah. So when you start to see some leaders, on both men and women, both American and European and Asian, saying, this is no longer something we are going to tolerate, and that's really what they've been doing, it will change. But I think women have got to start talking about it more. Mm-hmm. You know, for a lot of us, we kind of got numb to it. It's been around for so long, it sort of was part of our lore, and then we all just moved ahead and did our thing. But, and so I think we've lost that trend of looking after the next generation coming up and making sure, wait a minute, it was bad enough that we fought it, but they shouldn't have to fight it too, and let's fight it together. Mm-hmm. So it's a little bit of, I'm going to hold on to my baton, but I'm also going to pass a part of it to you, or keep my torch and light yours. Yeah. So I think we're going to see an intergenerational effort by women and men too, to say it's really time. I love that young women are speaking out about it. They're just so strong about it.
So I
also think we are seeing governments take action. So little things like seeing the 30% requirements for boards in Europe are starting also to challenge the question that we used to say, well, we didn't like quotas, or we didn't think numbers really were, numerical goals were really important or a right or appropriate. And I think for those of us who even used to think that, we've changed and now say, well, you know what?
They work.
They work, and we ought to be using them everywhere we can. Yeah. And yes, sign me up for that.
Yeah.
So I think that's a big change.
Yeah, I've noticed that trend too.
Yeah.
When it comes to, you know, we also know obviously there is the gender gap, but there's also a universal confidence gap.
Yes.
And that's something, you know, I guess I work a lot in that space. When it comes to women having more confidence and owning their value and putting themselves forward and speaking up and acting with the same level of assertiveness and self-belief that we see men do.
Right.
You know, what have you seen in terms of in your career and women around you where it's their own lack of belief in themselves?
Right.
Holding them back.
Holding them back. I was just going to use those very words. We hold ourselves back. And we do it for so many different reasons. Sometimes it's that we think we've got to be perfect, and so we don't give ourselves room to move on to the next job until we really have mastered this one. Sometimes we think we don't have all the qualifications, even though a man will go for a job if he has 3 of the qualifications out of 10. A woman won't go unless she has 7.
Or 10.
Yeah. So we hold ourselves to a very different standard than men hold themselves. And third, you know, we don't model ourselves after men because we sometimes think, well, I don't want to be like that. But in fact, there's a way to be assertive without necessarily verging over onto aggressive. There's a way to stand up for yourself without putting other people down. And so women have to be able to see other women do that and recognize that worked, that didn't ostracize her. And in fact, there's behavior there that I should do, and not just in my work life, it's probably right that if you're not standing up for yourself at work, you may not be at school for your children, at home with your spouse or partner. And so it's a little like when you give a woman a cell phone for one purpose, she figures out how to empower herself for other things. So I think this is an empowering issue overall.
Across the board, the board. You know, and I know that can come up with, you know, that imposter syndrome, I don't know if you know, where we have this fear of
being found out.
Do you ever have that?
I had it big time. I was a 26-year-old press secretary in a senator's office, and I got up every morning and just prayed, no one's gonna find out today that I really don't know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And I the good part is I worked really hard and I learned a lot. And one day I looked around and thought, you know, I guess I do know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
But it took a long time to get over it. And it actually took me till my 50s. And somebody said, you know, Kathy, you just don't have to work that hard anymore. But working hard is what I do. But now I'm trying to work smarter and not out of that fear of failure as much as dream of success. And I think there's sometimes that it's a healthy balance to hold on to both, but not out of the imposter fear as much as it holds women back, but more out of that recognition.
And I think that that's so true. It's how much we're driven by what we're afraid of and what scares us versus what inspires us. And I know with imposter syndrome, research shows that women tend to just work really, 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 really hard to show that they really are worthy of it. Whereas sometimes men tend to avoid situations where they might be exposed as, you know, they might realize, I really don't know what I'm doing. But when it comes to women having big goals and moving toward what excites and inspires them, I mean, when you started out, your career has been extraordinary in that you've had, you know, you've worked in media and you've worked in politics and in for profit, but not for profit, obviously now at the United Nations Foundation. You know, did you always have a big vision for yourself, or did it sort of unfold organically over time?
I had no big vision. My only big vision was I want to be in a place where I really like the people, where I will feel meaningful work was done, and that I'm having fun.
Yeah.
So I think the challenge for me always was that I never could see that the next career might be in a place where a career hadn't existed before. So I remember when I went to AOL, my father said, "What the heck is that?
Yeah.
That can't be a real business." And of course, it's changed the world. My role there was not as a technician, but as a translator. And so one thing I've looked back at is, what is it about my skill set that hasn't depended on the job I'm in per se, but is something that I've been able to use in every different job? So in politics, I translated the politician and his policies to an electorate. At U.S. News and World Report, that's the essence of journalism, is taking complex subjects and making them usable for people in their daily lives. At America Online, it was how to engage people in this brand new technology that sooner or later they would use to shop and educate themselves and connect.
They couldn't even imagine all of
that. It just was a boy toy.
Yeah.
And then coming to actually to support the United Nations, I once again thought, oh my goodness, what do I know? Well, I know how to help people understand the value of an institution that's saving lives around the world, that's making the U.S. a safer place because we're making other places more prosperous and safe. So again, it's all about translation. So for me, one of the solutions to overcoming that female fear was finding out, well, what am I good at that is actually translatable to almost everything else I do? Mm-hmm. And it turned out to be translation itself.
Interesting. Yeah. So there are a lot of women that I come across who feel hemmed in their careers or in their lives.
Right.
And sometimes lack the courage to take the risk and go, I'm going to change. I'm going to go into something that I haven't done before. There's that aversion to, I know I can do this. I've built up a reputation in this. This is safe, and that's not.
Yeah.
But they feel stuck. Yeah. And they're not necessarily, they're kind of languishing.
Right.
And so what would you say to a woman who is in that situation?
So I'd say you better make that decision yourself before somebody makes it for you.
Yeah.
Because that person is known to everybody as somebody who's stuck.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not just you who thinks that when that's the case. And if you're stuck that much that you're feeling it and you're worried about taking the leap wherever it might be, or leaning in, as Cheryl says, everybody else can see that you're not leaning in. So that's not good for you wherever you are. And it may not even mean leaving the place you're in, but it may require leaving the spot you're in. And so I know everybody has this vision of a ladder is the way you have to move through an organization, but today's world is actually lattice.
Yeah.
And so it, the definition of growth is really changing. So it may not be that you are moving from associate director to executive director, or these old ways we thought about titles, but more you're getting an experience with a team that does something over here, and then you're learning how to do sales over here, and then that's going to take you here.
Yeah.
I think that would be my solution for someone who's stuck, is it, you don't have to necessarily totally leave. You can also try to make changes in your own environment. But if that fails, it's probably better to take it on and bite the bullet before it gets handed to you.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think so often that fear of change, we kind of discount the cost of inaction.
Yes.
Like go, oh, well, I'll just ride it out a bit longer, and not realizing 5 years from now you could find yourself out of a job. And our skill sets can get obsolete too. And I see that happen where people, if they're not developing themselves and skill sets, as you just said, you can move from one area to another and just broaden out the things that you've had experience with.
I think as little girls, we grow up thinking other people will do things for us or tell us what to do. And so we kind of keep waiting around for that to happen. It's a little of the, you know, the Prince Charming syndrome. He'll come and rescue me and take me off, and I don't have to be responsible for planning out my life. And while I don't think a plan in today's world necessarily works, I think a bunch of planning can work. You know, do I need languages? Do I need some additional training? Do I need to get on a board where I might get some skills that I don't have now, or meet 20 people that I don't have now? I'm a big fan of networks. You know, it's like now very popular, and you know, LinkedIn or wherever you want to use a network. But I actually think real human networks are very valuable too, because it's often the case that you won't know where to look for that next job, but if you're in enough networks, it may find you. And you have to be, it's a little like luck.
You have to
get yourself out there in order for luck to to attach to you.
And you know, I know for me, just it's been putting myself out there and out there and out there. And you never know which things are going to come off. And some relationship you've had with someone that you met 3 years ago, tell someone else something, and then that turns into some fantastic opportunity. So it is about that, putting yourself out there and connecting. And sometimes, you know, sometimes people don't like networking very much. It's uncomfortable. It's awkward. They feel it's a bit artificial.
It's time consuming.
And women particularly, I think men are much more comfortable handing out a business card or saying, hey, call me, let's play golf, whatever it is. And women sort of go, oh, I don't want to see like I'm selling myself.
Yes. Yeah, and even I would say I watch young women here, and you've spoken here to our employees a couple times, and the questions I hear them ask are so basic about and knowing when to put their when to lean in or put themselves forward, when to object or offer a different point of view, what to do when they offered the point of view and nobody responded, which happens to everyone, but somehow we as women often feel it happens more to us. And then to look inside themselves and say, well, what part of that was me? That I could have maybe done it differently, and I'm going to commit to doing it differently next time.
But unless you're doing it, and I think to your point, putting forward an opinion where there's a risk that people mightn't agree with it, there's a risk people might think it's silly. But you've got to take that risk, and I think when we hold back from that, we deprive people of the value we have to bring. And we miss an opportunity to build our personal brand. And you're so right, it's risking that possibility. And I think you mentioned earlier about women, we set the standards so high for ourselves. And we have that perfectionist, I've got to know everything before I do something or even say something.
You must
come across that.
Well, and in the Washington and New York worlds, where expertise is highly valued and everybody is really smart. So we have a phrase here, it's probably not all that lovely, but it's mansplaining. So sometimes men are very good at explaining the world to us, and I think women feel, oh, come on, let's just have an honest exchange of views. I don't really need you to explain the whole world to me. And so I think at that point, a lot of women shut down, mm-hmm. as opposed to having, well, this is my point of view, or this is how I would come at it, or or even a really well-timed question. I'm a big question asker. Mm-hmm. I actually listen a lot because I'm happier listening. Mm-hmm. But then that gives me the one time I'm ready to come back in with the mm-hmm. one thing I want to say. Mm-hmm. And I don't always know what that is going in. So it takes me a while to listen,
yeah.
to know where I want to land and leave my last impression. So mm-hmm. I'm much more interested in my last impression than my first one.
No, that's yeah. interesting. So we know that when there's more women sitting at decision-making tables, better decisions are made.
Yes.
Yet, you know, only 10% of roles, women are in like 10% of executive roles globally, whether right. you look at politics across the board at the senior levels. So what do you see that women bring mm-hmm. that leads to, I mean, better economic, as you said earlier, better economic outcomes, everyone's better off. But what is it that women bring?
Well, so I've thought about this a lot, and I come back to an answer that starts with what really makes a difference at the table is diversity. And so it's not always that a woman will bring the softer side
yep.
or the more compassionate point of view or an issue that maybe a man wouldn't bring, because I'm not sure we're all that different anymore. But if you don't have diversity, you're missing, mm-hmm. you're definitely going to miss some different points of view. So I think the challenge is not only looking for the diversity of gender, but also age and ethnic background and to some degree experience. So I think the companies that have really committed themselves to inclusiveness and diversity show that they have better results, and that includes women.
Mm-hmm.
I do think women are by nature more collaborative. But collaboration is becoming, you know, a 21st century skill.
Mm-hmm.
So I wouldn't go so far as to say, well, men aren't collaborative, but they've been, my generation, and see, this is a generational answer too, my generation has a bit more of the command and control, top down,
yeah.
I'll get it done, you can join in.
But
younger guys, yeah. I think, have grown up in a different school system, they've seen women on the sports fields. I think sports has done more for women's confidence level,
yeah.
sense of their own ability, risk taking. It teaches you all of those things. You can lose a game today and win a game tomorrow. Those are invaluable tools,
mm-hmm.
and so the work that Title IX in our country gave us
yeah.
by showing women that they could learn all of those things and then bring them into the workforce, bring them into their lives has been great.
Yeah. You just brought up girls learning to be competitive and how to handle losing.
Yeah.
And I think resilience is just so crucial to just
yeah.
being successful at anything.
Right.
When you look back, you know, on your career and all the experiences you've had, what's an experience you've had that at the time felt like maybe a bit of a kick in the gut, or you'd done something you thought, ah, that was a mistake, I wouldn't have done that in hindsight, that you had to sort of pick yourself up again and move on? And what was it that helped you do that?
Well, there's so many. I'm being flooded with bad memories. So I think the things that come up when I hear that are, you know, a decision to simple things to release a report or a story for the senator on an exclusive basis that backfired.
Mm-hmm.
So I do a lot of judgment questioning, and I carry a lot of responsibility for not doing something that hurts others. So when those things are involved, I find myself pretty devastated. But I always feel the mistake is only as bad as what you do afterward in trying to both fix it and learn from it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't do anything, if you go in your hole, the mistake only gets bigger.
Yeah.
The sooner you get to it, the sooner you start to put something around it, the better. So I'm a very fast judgment maker about, uh-oh, did that go well, did that go badly? I'm a very fast solution trier. Uh-oh, better get down these three paths really quickly. And I'm really fast to reach out to somebody else and have them test my judgment.
Mm-hmm.
Both the feedback, hey, wait a minute, it wasn't so bad,
mm-hmm.
or, well,
Yeah.
You better get on this, but here's three things you could do, because in the heat of that moment, your confidence in your abilities to react is low.
Mm-hmm.
I made this mistake, why aren't, what's to say I'm not gonna make it? Another mistake. So I think, you know, learning to build in those resilience tools that give you reaction mode so you don't do this, because we've all done that. You start that swirl and
you go,
but that doesn't serve anybody.
Downhill.
Yeah.
Exactly. And you know, I see people sometimes have had a setback and then they have another one and they end up getting very demoralized and checking out.
Right.
Which doesn't serve anyone either.
Yeah.
So when it comes to just dealing with the daily stresses, I mean, you're in a big job. You've got a lot of people who expect a lot from you. You've got people who are looking for you to deliver some really big, big things. How do you manage just all of those expectations? And sometimes when you've got more on your plate than you feel you have time and the energy and resources to handle, how do you manage that so that you don't find yourself getting stressed out?
Yeah. So stress is a big thing to avoid. I've come to really think sleep and stress are two lessons that we sort of learn late in life. Early on, you think I can do it with very little sleep and I can handle stress. Actually, nobody does well with too little of one and too much of the other. So I have learned, but I'm still not exactly where I'd love to be, to take time in the morning to kind of get my, I often go to bed at night, you know, doing that mental checklist of
what's
good
on tomorrow?
Stuff, bad stuff, and then what's carrying on to tomorrow. I'm thinking, oh, could have done better. But I'm resilient about getting up in the morning with it's a new day, I have a new opportunity, and I pick one thing I'm really gonna nail today. That helps me then
one
drive
thing.
Through the whole day. I'm also really conscious that I model for people, and even when you're not looking, you're modeling. Somebody's watching, somebody's reading your confidence, your enthusiasm, your outlook, and picking up on it or not. And I really believe in positive energy. So I try my hardest to share that and keep some of my negative energy
to yourself,
to myself as much as I can.
Yeah.
And I think it's a good time also to acknowledge and recognize when you could step back a bit and let somebody else step forward. If you're feeling that you've got too much else going on in your mind to really have the big picture. But I also have learned to draw from others, you know, that when I'm struggling, feeling I've got way too much, that I need to just step back and think, who could help me get this, get through this?
Yeah.
But it's not easy.
Yeah.
And the more you take on, and I tend to take on a lot, but I think anybody who has a big career and a busy life, the more successful you are, the more you do take on. It the challenge is of how to actually start to say no. So I think saying no is another thing that women have to learn over time. I just did one in my office right now. I felt so good about it.
Well,
it's not always easy.
Yeah, no, yeah. It's not.
Because we've been rewarded so often for being willing and eager, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that people-pleasing driver is so strong. I have so many people tell me, I said yes, I'm like, why?
Yeah.
It came out of my mouth before I even had chance to
and
reel it in.
I have to say, today, something that I'm asked to do 3 months from now, everything looks easy 3 months from now. And you forget, oh my God, there's a lot of stuff in between. So you sometimes don't use your best judgment.
Yeah. So I'm just finishing. When it comes to helping women just step up to the plate in their lives, to own their power, to be leaders in their own right and in their own way, and to help them overcome that little inner critic in their own head, you know, you've obviously helped a lot of women see themselves differently and really have a bigger vision for what they see as possible. But what do you think women can be doing more of to help lift other women as they climb?
So I think there's a few things. We each need to take more responsibility for looking for the opportunity for another woman. And it may be to go to lunch and just share ideas. It may be that one piece of work ought to go to somebody who's not there. Second, we ought to pay more attention to the data. So do we have gender equity around us? Do we have gender parity in salary? Do we have gender equity in the opportunities that women have? And do we have an equality environment where there's a lot of diversity? And I press the diversity piece because I think if we're just thinking about women, it makes women feel like the secondary citizens and victims, where we really want a totally diverse environment, which recognizes us all differently. Third, I think listening is really important. Sometimes people are telling us things about themselves in language and vocabulary we don't recognize because we're moved on. And so I try to listen really hard for that timid voice I hear somebody else using to sort of know when to kind of step in and help and challenge and maybe mirror just a little bit.
Yeah. Well, Kathy, I want to say thank you for just giving me your time today. I really, really am grateful for it. And
thank you for writing your books because they help.
Yeah.
They really do.
Well, thanks. And, you know, I think all of us need encouragement at times to just stop and go, okay, what's driving my decisions and where do I need to be driven more by something big that excites me, inspires me, gives me a sense of purpose and meaning, and not by what I'm afraid might happen.
All right. And dream big.
Yeah.
Gloria Steinem says, if you don't dream big, you'll never have the ability to get ahead. And anyway, isn't dreaming then leading to planning? And so go for it.
Yeah, that's how we came to be here today. Yeah. So thanks for saying yes to me.
Yes. I never say no to you.
Okay, thank you.